When you wish upon a star, makes no difference who you are.
Each week as you enter this timeless land, one of these many worlds will open to you. Frontierland. Tall tales and true from the legendary past. Tomorrowland. Promise of things to come. Adventureland. The wonder world of nature's own realm. Fantasyland. The happiest kingdom of them all. Presenting this week, Tricks of Our Trade. And now, your host, Walt Disney.
Because the animated cartoon comes to life on the screen, it belongs in the field of the motion picture. But because it is drawn and painted, it is also one of the graphic arts, like painting. As a matter of fact, it is often referred to as the last of the graphic arts. Late in being born, animation had a lot of catching up to do. Being new, it had very little to draw upon out of past human experience. We in the industry have seen animation principles that now seem perfectly obvious, hailed as astounding discoveries. Before our eyes, we have seen an entire industry grow, literally from the ground up. And this growth was no accident. It was painstakingly built, step by step, by men with pioneering spirit who loved this puzzling new art form and believed in its future. Here in our book, The Art of Animation, is the story of these men and an account of what was probably the strangest educational effort ever recorded. In the chapter called Tricks of Our Trade, we take you into a unique schoolhouse where the pupils were their own teachers. They had to be because no one in the world could give them the answer to what they wanted to know. Their question was, how could animation be improved? From early in the morning until late at night, somewhere in the studio, school was in session. Somewhere, someone was trying to find out what happened when things moved.
Let's take a look at this film, fellas. I think we can learn something from it. Stan, would you catch the lights, please?
Sure thing, Jerry.
This is the comedian, Billy House. We had him do the step because a fat man moves in such a way that... Well, here's some slow motion of the action. It'll show you what I mean. This is a good example of how the human figure does not move all in one piece. For example, compare the overlapping actions of the stomach and shoulders. Watch how elastic the figure is.
Hey, take a look at his legs and feet. Notice the follow-through on the pant legs? How they come down late every time, after the feet come down.
He sure makes good contact with the floor.
Yeah, and you've got to admit, this figure has plenty of weight.
No, I mean the way he moves.
Yeah. This film shows all the basic animation principles. But it's a funny thing. When the action is run at a normal speed again, you can hardly see these things. But even though they are not noticeable, they are all still happening. And they all add up to lifelike animation. Weight, contact, follow through, squash and stretch, overlapping actions. Yep, they're all there now.
From our school of action analysis came the ability to make the cartoon figures move convincingly. But the trick of creating a cartoon character with a real personality requires something more than proper movement. In order to really come to life, the character's actions must appear to come from his own thoughts and feelings. In other words, the cartoon character must seem to have a cartoon brain. For only the thinking character can become a personality. While it's true that thoughts and emotions can be expressed in terms of bodily action and pantomime, what a character is and what he thinks can best be revealed by dialogue. This trick of using dialogue to establish personality was used in our first cartoon feature, Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. Let's take the episode where Snow White first meets the little men. The dwarfs have just returned from the mine and found Snow White asleep on their beds. She has already seen their names on their beds, and now observing their speech habits and personality, it is no trick at all for Snow White to guess who is who.
Now, don't tell me who you are. Let me guess. I know. You're Duck.
Why, yes. That's true.
And you're...
You're Bashful.
Oh, gosh.
And you? You're Sleepy.
Oh, yes.
And you? You're Sneezy. Yes, and you must be...
Happy, ma'am. That's me. And this is Dopey. He don't talk none.
You mean he can't talk?
He don't know. He never tried.
Represent an emperor's crown, nor a strange tropical flower. It is a raindrop splashing. Actions of this type are the work of a group of specialists here at the studio and represent a very important trick of our trade. It's the trick of making the cartoon characters themselves more believable by using extremely realistic animation of the incidental actions. The character's shadow, a puff of dust or smoke, a forest fire, a volcano erupting, or in this case, the splash of a raindrop. We call all these actions effects animation. As the animated cartoon industry grew bigger and we began to make cartoon features, there was an increasing demand for more convincing effects animation. And so, a group of our highly skilled animators was enrolled in a new course of self-education. Here we see the effects animators at their studies.
Hello,
This may give the impression of sabotage in the schoolhouse or pupils at play while the teacher's away. Actually, it is nothing of the sort. These are earnest students of animation trying to find out exactly what happens, when it happens, how it happens, and why. By slowing the action down, they could observe exactly what did happen. This film was photographed at the speed of 3,000 frames per second. In this way, the action, which occurred in 1 second, was slowed down to take place on the screen in 120 seconds, or 2 full minutes. One of the things brought out very clearly by these studies was that animating breakage or shattering effects of any sort required tremendous attention to detail. This applied all the way from animating a shattering window to the cataclysmic effects of an earthquake. For instance, in The Rite of Spring, number from Fantasia, occurred one of the most elaborate man-made earthquakes our effects department was ever called upon to animate. When occasion demanded it, the students went to even greater lengths in setting up a laboratory experiment. The problem in this next case, how to simulate the very creation of our planet. They wanted to depict in close-up the seething and bubbling of the Earth's surface during creation, and they wanted a mock-up to study how it might have looked. For the molten lava, they had to resort to a substitute. They finally agreed to settle for orange-colored mud. Here is Joshua Metter, one of our effects animators. He was in charge of the project. Two other effects animators, Jack Boyd and Dan McManus, had been assigned to the project, and each had chosen his own special field of study. Jack here, who was analyzing the basic animation problem, had decided to narrow it down to the individual action of a pair of bubbles. This two-drawing flipping action is the reliable trick by which animators prove the workability of their extremes and check the animation. Josh was making use of colored chalks and pastels in rendering sketches that would give an overall comprehensive impression of the sequence. Josh's difficulty was that his models wouldn't hold still for him. It's a good thing for Josh that this wasn't real red-hot lava. Dan's problem was to discover exactly how many drawings it would take to animate the bursting of a bubble. For this, he used a special chart called an exposure sheet. First, he sketched the principal stages of the action. To time the duration of each part of this action, he used a stopwatch, making rapid calculations and mentally translating seconds into frames of film. In this way, he was able to determine that the splashing position of the bubble would occur exactly on drawing number 29. In the meantime, Josh had almost finished his colored pastel rendering. Now, all concerned with the picture would have an idea how it might look in the theater. So, out of care, calculation, and concentration came one of the classics of the effects animator's art. The creation. From cosmic to microcosmic is a long, long jump, but not for the effects animators. The splash of a single little raindrop deserved as much attention as the birth of a planet. Because a raindrop was small, it didn't naturally follow that it would be easy to animate. For one thing, the speed at which it happened made study almost impossible. Slow motion photography again came to the rescue. Oddly enough, it was milk and not water that proved the most practical medium to work with. The weight and density of milk, as well as its opaque appearance, more clearly revealed what transpired during a splash. While all splashes were basically alike, there nevertheless was a surprising variety in the pattern of each individual one. A thorough analysis of the action patterns of a splash showed the way to greater authenticity. And soon, strange shapes and forms appeared upon the animator's drawing board. Drawing by drawing, a little raindrop had been created, and the secret of the raindrop led naturally to a summer rainstorm. In this way, an entire sequence was brought to life on the screen for our cartoon feature, Bambi. Here at the studio, we call it a raindrop sequence. Now, this is a different kind of drawing. It also came out of our school of self-improvement here at the studio. It is the blueprint of a piece of equipment designed to make cartoons more realistic and enjoyable. This is the plan for a super cartoon camera. We call it the Multiplane camera. It was intended for use in our feature-length cartoons. You see, we decided for features. The camera needed improvement, too. Actually, the pre-feature cartoon camera was fairly simple in construction and operation, and generally very satisfactory. Here, a Mickey Mouse short is being put on film. Mickey has been inked and painted on transparent sheets of celluloid. This happens to be a panorama effect where the character will walk in one place and the background keeps moving behind him to create the illusion. Each time a new cell of Mickey is photographed, the background must be moved a fraction of an inch. Photographing each one of these celluloids of Mickey and background makes a single frame of motion picture film. And here's how the action looks on the screen. Now note that our character is capable of giving us a real feeling of three dimensions. He can move farther away and come closer. He can turn so that we see all sides of him. He seems to have roundness. There's nothing flat about him. He can almost poke his finger in your eye. But when he leaves... when he leaves, whatever dimension he has given the scene leaves with him. Now, the unnatural flatness of the background becomes evident. But besides being merely unrealistic, the old-fashioned flat background can also create a false effect. For instance, when our camera moves in closer on this moonlight scene, you'll notice that everything grows larger, including the moon. Now, when you walk along a country road toward the moon, it certainly doesn't grow larger like this, nor does it shrink in size when you walk away from it. The problem was how to take a painting
and make it behave like a real piece of scenery under the camera. The trouble was we were photographing a flat two-dimensional background. So we set about making plans and blueprints for a new cartoon camera that would overcome this. The different elements in the scene were separated according to their varying distances from the viewer. This put the moon on a plane farthest away from the camera. With our original picture broken down in this manner, it is possible to control the relative speed with which each individual part of it moves to or away from the camera. But the moon remains absolutely still, and so it will always remain the same, neither growing nor shrinking in size. Of course, our cartoon camera does not shoot sideways, but is placed above and shoots downward toward the drawing. Since this new camera used many planes, we called it the Multiplane camera. And here now is our same moonlight scene, the way the Multiplane camera sees it. As you can see, we finally got the moon to keep its proper distance. This trick of obtaining a feeling of real depth and dimension in our painted backgrounds was used extensively in the feature cartoons. Perhaps an outstanding example of this occurs in the opening scenes of our cartoon feature, Bambi. Here we see the Multiplane camera crew preparing to shoot that scene. Here are the planes for that scene, each with its own separate part of the background painted in oil on glass. Each of these background planes is placed on one of the levels under the camera. Each plane is capable of moving in various directions. Here we see one being moved sideways. The camera operator, looking down from the viewpoint of the camera, sees all the levels combined as one picture. From his view, we can see how each level or plane can move independently of the others. Here, the operator of each level is bringing his particular part of the background into the right position to start the scene. But before the scene can be photographed, the camera operator must okay the setup.
Everything's okay except the bottom level. What's wrong down there, Alan?
I was moving it the wrong way, Dick. I'm taking it back now. How's that?
Looks fine now. Okay, we've got that frame. Let's get set for the second exposure.
In our frame-by-frame method of photographing a cartoon scene, the feeling of depth is not actually too evident when the scene is under the camera. You might be thinking that it looks as flat as the old-fashioned type of cartoon background. In fact, it does while it holds still. The trick of the Multiplane camera is movement. Perhaps the thing that distinguishes animated cartoons more than anything else is the trick of caricature. Closely allied with this is satire. In 1940, we decided to animate a satire of the famous ballet, Dance of the Hours, for our musical feature, Fantasia. While ballet has inspired many beautiful works of art like this painting by Degas, it had scarcely been touched upon in the field of animation. In fact, our animators knew very little about it. And because a thorough knowledge of a subject is essential in order to caricature it, a new course was added to our studio school curriculum, classical ballet. The ballet steps are being modeled by Helene Stanley.
Helene has been very helpful in this way on several occasions, particularly as Cinderella, and again in the title role of another of our cartoon features, Sleeping Beauty. Here we see four of our key animators engrossed in their assignment. Ollie Johnston, Frank Thomas, Mark Davis, and Milt Call are trying to adapt classical ballet to animation.
Hey, Mark, take a look here, will you? Am I getting into this kick okay?
Let's watch her go through it a couple of more times. Would you mind doing that action where you throw your arms up and kick out your legs, please?
Well, this routine consists of several individual steps. First is the pas de bourrée. Second, arabesque. Third, glissade assemblé.
That's the one.
Fourth, développé, and then back into the bow. And altogether, the combination looks like this.
You know, she seems to give quite a strong push with her left leg when she takes off.
Seems to me she ought to push off with both legs in order to get all that weight off the ground. She's no cream puff, you know.
Yeah, that is a lot of beef. She's very funny when she sags that way. Helps bring out the wrinkles.
I kind of like that clumsy little hop she does. Might get a laugh, you know?
Yeah, but you got to be careful not to overdo it.
Overdo it? Oh, Mark. The slower the better.
Well, maybe you're right.
I don't know if I've got this or not. Would you take a look? Is her trunk too long?
Oh, no. That's because of that goofy look. Trunk's way out of proportion to the rest of her body.
Yeah. Yeah, her legs are real short and stubby.
Hey, it wouldn't hurt to make them good and hairy. Some prima ballerina, eh?
Regular Pavlova.
Sure brings out the beast in her.
Hey, Mark, how's this?
What's that?
Does that capture the spirit of the classical ballet?
Yeah. I especially like the long, scrawny neck. It ought to be great in animation.
Don't overlook her knobby knees, either.
Knobby is right.
Well, would it be better if I were to exaggerate the knees a little more?
No. No, I think she's knock-kneed enough as it is. If I were you, I'd concentrate on her feet.
Yeah, she has big feet.
Think those are big? Look, when you have big feet, do something with them.
Big feet.
Sure, but do they have to be that big?
I think they're just about right. Size 12s, I'd say.
Real gunboats.
Big feet.
You know, that's where we're going to get our real caricature. We've got to emphasize all these funny little things that are typical of ballet and ballet dancers.
A little ballet skirt would make a good prop. It could follow through on every action.
And let's not forget we need different material in the last part of the ballet, different costume, and the steps could be more dramatic, kind of sneaky maybe.
Say, that's fine. That hat and cape would be real great for the alligator.
Yeah, the cape makes a swell prop for a villain.
Sure. Let's try it out. Do you have any good villain-type steps?
Oh, sure. Let's try. Is that all right?
Good. Now look fierce.
Now, could we see the whole thing again?
Our studio classrooms came more believable character animation,
more realistic effects animation, and improved camera techniques. And out of our class in ballet and caricature came inspiration for the Dance of the Hours.
This has been an ABC Television Network film.